that ye shall speak, he will show you all things. The truth is very important. Amen. Our truth that we know is the gospel of Jesus Christ. Yes, it's the very foundation, Brother Ray, on what we stand. Without truth, everything would be of none importance. Our victory is established by the finished works of Jesus Christ. And this is the gospel of Jesus Christ. It's his death, it's his burial, and his resurrection. That's what our truth is based on. That's why it's so true. It's so important that we know what the Bible says, Brother Larry, and how we understand it. The truth is important. The truth is a standard by which we live. And I looked that word up, standard, and that word standard means it's a measure. A rule or a measure. So God's word or God's truth is a rule or a measure that we live by. I said it will lead and guide us. That's why it's critical that you and I study and know the truth, because it's what we guard ourselves about with. When the enemy comes attacking us, we can quote the word. That's what Jesus did in Matthew chapter 4 after he had fasted 40 days and 40 nights. Well, Larry spoke about it the other night. He began to quote the word to him. He began to defeat the enemy with the word of God. The truth, the word of God is important to us. To gird up your loins in the Roman era meant to draw up and tie your lower garment between your legs to increase mobility and agility. As we gird up the loins of our minds with God's truth, it's for us to secure anything that's going to cause us to stumble and fall in the battlefield. You know why it's important to know the truth? Because the Bible says that Satan is the father of all lies.
Right, yeah.
He's the father of all lies. So if you know the truth, he can't defeat you with a lie.
Amen.
If you know the truth, he can't defeat you with a lie. Because you know what the Word of God says. You know what the truth is. That's why it's important that we know the Word of God. That's why it's so important. That's why I like Bible study.
Yes.
I like when Willie Gio gives us Bible study. I like when preaching goes for you. Because the Word gives us strength.
Yes.
The Word gives us that fight that we can fight the enemy with.
Amen.
It's very, very important. The next piece of armor that is listed is the breastplate of righteousness. The Roman soldier's breastplate was made of metal plates, chains, or hard leather. It covered the body from neck to the waist, both front and the back. The ones made of large pieces of metal were molded or hardened to conform to the body. And this piece of armor provided protection to the vital organs, such as the heart and the lungs. So he would wear it, so the soldier would wear it over the top of him to protect him from an enemy's thrust or from a dagger or from a sword. Webster's dictionary defines righteousness as integrity or purity of the heart. The righteousness that we have will come from God and God only. The righteousness that you and I have will only come through Jesus Christ. Romans 3:22 tells us that. I'm trying to keep up with my slides, and y'all just bear with me. Romans 3:22 says, even the righteousness of God, which is by faith in Jesus Christ, and to all and open of all them that believe, for there is no difference. We change the way that we live, and we change the way that we act. We change the things about us, because there's none righteous. The Bible says there's none righteous at all. But when we're filled with the Holy Ghost, when we're repented of our sins, and we're filled with the Holy Ghost, and we've been baptized in Jesus' name, we change. The old man's passed away. Behold, all things have become new. We're a new creature in Christ Jesus, Brother Billy. A new creature. We change the way. Because why? Because we're filled with the Holy Ghost, which is the Spirit of God, which brings to us righteousness. Romans 6:13 and 14 says, neither yield ye your members as instruments of unrighteousness unto sin, but yield yourselves unto God as those that are alive from the dead. As your members as instruments of righteousness unto God, for sin shall not have dominion over you. For ye are not under the law, but under grace. The basic meaning of the word righteousness is to be made right before God. To be made right before God, living a life that is right before Him. Our breastplate protects our hearts. Proverbs 4:23 says, keep thy heart with all diligence, for out of it are the issues of life. Be careful. Matthew 15:18 says, but those things which proceeded out of the mouth come from the heart, and they defile the man. It controls our speech. It controls how we act. The heart is evil. I believe the Bible tells us that the heart is evil. I told you last week that Genesis 6, God said that He seen that men's hearts were on evil continually. So that's why it's important we have on the breastplate of righteousness. Luke 6:4-5 says, a good man out of the good treasures of his heart bring forth that which is good, and an evil man out of the evil treasures of his heart bringeth forth that which is evil. For out of the abundance of the heart his mouth speaketh. What comes out here is usually what's in here. It's very important that we guard that. I remember teaching on fasting one time, and the word fast, the Hebrew or the other word for fast is to sum. And what it means is to cover one's mouth. The word for fast means to cover one's mouth. And as I began to teach, I began to look at that. I thought, well, not only does that apply for us when we're doing without food, when we're fasting, that means going without food, putting our body under suggestion. But a lot of times that means to cover this mouth up and keep from speaking words that we shouldn't be speaking. Saying things that we shouldn't be talking about. So it goes both ways, but it's always from the heart that it comes forth. We need to be clothed with the breastplate of righteousness, both in character and in conduct. Somebody said that character, your character is what you are when you're with nobody, when you're by yourself. That's how you are. It's not when you're around your friends or how you act. True character will always show its true colors. If we fail to do this, we become open to attack. Our prayers should be, God, filter everything that comes into or out of my heart through your righteousness. Sometimes it's not always easy to keep this on tongue quiet. It's an unruly member of the Bible speaks about it. Set of fire the whole course of nature. No man can tame the tongue. It's important. The breastplate provides protection for the hearts, the lungs, and the intestines and other vital organs. In ancient Jewish thinking, the heart represented the mind and the will, and the bowels represented the emotions and the feeling. It's Satan's goal to attack what we know is right in our hearts. It upset our emotional balance, because if he can, we become easily discouraged. Yeah. Amen. I read that, I began to think about that, and I thought, you know, discouragement and depression are a real thing that people battle. Right. And that comes from the enemy. That comes from the devil. I go through times in my life, Brother Marcus, where I battled depression, and I battled those things. And it's really not right for a child of God to do that, but it's true. It's real. It actually happens to people. So it's important that we understand what I'm talking about this morning. True righteousness has always originated with God, and it's His standard of mode, it's His standard of behavior, and it's standard of character. God embodies righteousness because everything He has said and done is eternally right. They could not find any sin in Him. Yet they crucified Him anyway. He was right. There was nothing wrong with Him. The Bible makes reference to three types of righteousness. It speaks about first, which is self-righteousness. We're born without any righteousness. We don't have anything right in us. Brother Gill told us, what makes a little child lie? If somebody taught him that, somebody taught her that, it's just our nature. That's just the way it is. So we're not born with the ability to do the right thing sometimes. If I want to say it like that, I can say it like that. Isaiah 64 and 6 says, but we are all as an unclean thing, and all of our righteousness are like filthy rags. We all do faint and sleep, but our iniquities, like the wind, have taken us away. Romans 3 and 10 says, as it is written, there is none righteous, no, not one. Romans 3 and 23, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. We've all fallen, we've all failed because of unrighteousness. We have nothing that can protect us from the enemy. We cannot and never will be righteous without God in our life. We have to have Him in our life. The second thing He talks about is imputed righteousness. Webster defines the word imputed as to set to the account of another. So He takes His righteousness, Sister Leanne, He takes His righteousness out of His account and He puts it in mine, or He'll put it in yours. It's His righteousness that lives on the inside of me. It's like somebody taking money out of a banking account and putting it from one account to the next. That's what God does with His righteousness. He takes it from Himself and He gives it to us through the death, burial, and resurrection, through repentance, through water baptism, through the infilling of the Holy Ghost. That's how righteousness comes into our life. Imputed righteousness means that God has and will put His righteousness on our account and in our lives. 2 Corinthians 5:21 says, for He had made Him to be sin for us who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in Him. It's His righteousness, Sister Maria, that's living inside us, to us Christians, through the death, burial, and resurrection. The third thing that it speaks about is imparted righteousness. And Webster defines the word impart as to make known, to communicate, to reveal, to disclose. When God imputes His righteousness to us by His Spirit, it produces righteous living in our life. We want to do the right thing. We want to say the right things. We want to act the right way. We want to dress the right way when we have the righteousness of God living on the inside of us. And it's working, and we allow it to work. Philippians 1:11 says, being filled with the fruits of righteousness, which are by Christ Jesus, and to the glory and praise of God. When we have received God's imputed righteousness, we develop and manifest a hunger and a desire to live the right way, to act the right way, by our words and by our actions. Each and every day we put on the breastplate of righteousness, which comes from God. It enables us to protect our hearts and our emotions from the devil. Because Revelation 12:10 tells us that our enemy is an accuser of the brethren. He will cause us not only to accuse ourselves, but to accuse other people. He's an accuser of the brethren. And he does that because he's the one that fell. Because he was the one that made the mistake. And he wants us to do the same thing. When we do not wear the breastplate of righteousness, we leave ourselves open to the loss of joy, to the loss of fruitfulness, and to the loss of our heavenly reward. And not only does it do that, it brings reproach upon God and upon our church. The next piece of scripture, or the next piece of armor that the scripture speaks about, is our feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. How many of you know it's important, the shoes that you have on? My wife can wear a different pair of shoes for the next year and a half. she's going to throw something at me, but it's important. This next passage of scripture that we speak about is our feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. And in Paul's time, Roman and Jewish citizens normally wore a lightweight sandal, sometimes decorated with metal and jewels. They wanted to kind of look good. They had to bling on their shoes, if you will. But Roman soldiers, the one that went out to battle to fight, wore a pair of heavy, thick-soled shoes with leather straps that secured it to the foot. And on the bottom of the soles were little pieces of metal that protruded out like little spikes to give the soldier better traction so that he could stand in battle and fight in hand-to-hand combat. It was very important that his shoes give him the proper footing, because one wrong slip or one wrong move could mean his death. So his shoes were very, very important to him. The soldiers could hold his ground and they could make quick movements without slipping or sliding or falling. The shoes provided protection for long marches. The enemy would often place razor sharp sticks in the ground in hopes of piercing the soldier's feet to keep them from advancing in the battle. They would do all kinds of tricks to keep the soldier from being able to walk or to move. The covering of the feet is personal. We are to cover our feet with preparation, our readiness before we enter into battle. As I said before, it's important. The Bible says for us to stand. Don't go back. Don't retreat. Stand firm and hold your ground. If we are not ready, we will not be able to stand against the wiles of the devil and the tricks of the devil. And the Bible says, having done all to stand, it provides us with a Christian as a solid background, if you will. David said in Psalms 42, he said, he brought me up out of a horrible pit, and out of the miry clay, he set my feet upon a rock, and he established my goings. We are to prepare our feet with the gospel of peace. We stand firm in the gospel of peace, a peace that can only come from God. And the Bible speaks about two aspects of peace, and that's the peace of God and peace with God. Webster's Dictionary defines peace as quiet, a calm, or tranquility, where it's just, it's serene, it's beautiful. There's no noise taking place and everything. It's just, you're at peace with yourself. We experience real peace when we experience the presence of God or the Spirit of God. His peace enables us to fight against the devil, because we know that through God we can be victorious when we stand firm. Peace is also a fruit of the Spirit. I mean, I taught a series of lessons on the fruit of the Spirit, but the GLs talk about it, I'm sure Brother Larry's talked about it. But peace and the fruits of the Spirit can only come when we're connected to God. A tree and those limbs only grow because they're connected to the vines. And they draw their strength from that. So peace is a fruit of God, it's a fruit of the Spirit, and it comes from being connected to God. And once we are at peace with God, then we experience the peace of God. Once we are at peace with God, then we experience the peace of God. It's so important in our life. When everything around us is just in turmoil, when everything around us seems to be going wrong, we know that He's still in control. We still have the peace of God in our life. Jesus says in John 14:27, He said, "Peace I leave with you, peace I have given you, not as the world giveth, but give I unto you. Let not your hearts be troubled, neither let it be afraid." The peace of God comes from above, and it gives us the ability to rise above all difficulty. Peace settles, strengthens, and it stabilizes us. It strengthens us and it stabilizes us. It's very important. Philippians 4:7 says, "And the peace of God, which passeth all understanding, shall keep your hearts and mind through Christ Jesus." It's a peace that comes from God. Isaiah 26:3-4 says, "Thou wilt keep him in perfect peace, whose mind is stayed on thee, because he trusted in thee. Trust ye in the Lord forever, for in the Lord Jehovah is everlasting strength." God's peace is like a garrison of soldiers being placed around us. Around a child of God, the true peace of God cannot be broken by life storms or by the attack of our enemy, because true peace comes from God being in control. Having our feet shod with the preparation of peace gives us this ability to stand against the tricks of the enemy. Not only that, we're able to march forward or proceed in our battle and in our fight, to have our stability to walk with God. Paul tells us in Ephesians 4:14 that when henceforth be no more children tossed to and fro and carried about with every wind of doctrine by the sleight of men, cunningness and craftiness whereby they lie in wait to deceive us. If we are not grounded in the Word of God, we can easily be led astray. Instability will hinder or destroy our spiritual walk with God, because the gospel is the foundation that we stand on. Our shoes also gives us balance. Have you ever tried to walk on a gravel or hot pavement while you're barefooted? It's not easy to do. It's not easy to do. It burns our feet, so we're kind of that unstable. We're kind of off balance, if you will, as we try to walk. So our shoes gives us the mobility. Even the best and equipped protected soldier will be killed if it stands in one place too long. The Roman soldier's shoes were designed for mobility. He can move and he can turn quickly. He could adjust his position. They kept his feet comfortable so that he didn't tire out or become sore in our walk with God. We have to be willing to shift and move. We've got to be ready to change. We've got to be ready to fight the enemy, because he will try to change his tactics and he will try to change his way that he comes after us. And we've got to be ready to defeat him. We've got to be ready to respond. Our shoes provide us with the opportunity to take and share this gospel with somebody else. That's very important, that our shoes will be able to take us to share this gospel with somebody else. We are commanded to have our feet shod with the preparation of peace so that we can advance and fight in the battle. Romans 10:14-15 says, "How then shall they call upon him who have not believed? And how shall they believe in him they have not heard? And how shall they hear without a preacher? And how shall they preach unless they be sent? As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of them that preach the gospel of peace and bring tidings of good joy." Very important that our feet are shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Our next piece of armor is called the shield of faith. The Roman soldiers used several types of shield, but the thuros was the most common, as you will see in this picture. It's the shield of faith. Iron rims were fitted along the top and the bottom edges, and an iron circle was attached to the center of the shield. The colors of the soldier's military unit were sometimes painted on the leather covering, so their enemy knew who they were coming up against to battle with, who they were going to fight with. This is a very, very important piece of equipment right here, the shield of faith, if you will. These shields were made so that a row of soldiers could interlock their shields together to form a wall that could extend for more than a mile, a wall that would be very difficult for the enemy to penetrate, as you will see in this picture. They've got a shield over the top of them, and they've got a shield in front of them. The Roman military worked together using a formation of the layer known as the quarters. They would march in battle like this right here, being completely protected above the head and in front of them. And the tortoise, the rows of soldiers closed all gaps between one another, and they held their shields together as they would march in the battle. They were a unified force. I want you to keep that in mind. They were a unified force. The enemy would wrap their arrows in pieces of cloth that had been soaked in pitch and in tar. And then they would shoot their arrow. They would light them up and they would shoot their arrow, and on impact, it would splatter burning material all over these soldiers. So it was very important that these shields were above their heads, so as these arrows would land on them, this fire or this pitch or this tar would go all over the place. These shields would deflect that over there. It would scatter that. If it ever touched a piece of the soldier's clothing or anything, it would become a fire. They could easily deflect them in this form known as the tortoise. Charles Spurgeon, the great British minister, said he believed that the word that is translated as shield sometimes signifies a door. Because these ancient shields were as large as the door. They covered the man entirely. As the shield enveloped the man, so faith envelops the entire man or the entire Christian man or woman, protecting him from missiles, wherever they may be aimed against him. Faith protects the whole man. The shield of faith receives the blows that are meant for the man himself. Some Christians think that faith should enable them to escape the blows, that if they had faith, everything would be peace and calm, and at times it is. I talk about the peace that comes from God, but in the midst of the battle, our faith will stand firm. I said our faith will stand firm. But be armed with faith. He said it receives the blows. The poor shield is knocked and it's hammered, and it's battered like a house exposed to a storm. Blow after blow comes raining down upon it. And though it turns death aside, the shield is compelled itself to hear the cut and the thrust of the enemy's sword. So must our faith. So must our faith, Sister Judy, bear the blows and the cuts of the storms of life that we face and that we go through. If we did not have faith, we wouldn't have anything. I've often said, Brother Larry, if you can't believe Genesis 1 and 1 in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth, then you don't have faith. Then you don't have faith if you can't believe that. When we look at what the scripture says, we see the importance of the shield of faith. It can even be said that is our first line of defense against Satan's attack. Verse 16 starts by saying, above all, possibly meaning to cover the rest. You stop and think about it, in that formation that they were in the formation of the turtle, it actually covered all the other pieces of the armor, Brother Billy. So he says, above all, possibly meaning to cover the rest. The shield protects the rest of the armor. As stated earlier, our enemy knows our strength and our weaknesses. He has given a battle plan advice to use against us. He's never given up. And he will continue to throw the fiery darts our way. There are four common types of darts that he's going to throw at us. They're fear. And there's 365 fear nots in the Bible. 365 for a normal year, 365 for a leap year that we live in right now. A fear not for every day that we get up in the morning, Brother Larry. That's pretty amazing that's in the scripture. 365 fear nots in the Bible. We all struggle with fear at times. We fear things we cannot see, and we fear things that we can see. We fear things that never even happened. How many of you have ever worried about something that never even took place? We're all guilty of that. We all have fear. Fear will paralyze us. Fear will grip us. 1 John 4 tells us that God is love, and there is no fear in him, because perfect love casteth out fear. We can never allow fear in our walk with God. The second one is doubt. We doubt ourselves. We doubt how others feel about us, and we doubt our walk with God, and we often doubt his words. Number three is words. The old saying, sticks and stones may break my bones, but words will never hurt me, is not true. We've all had stuff said about us that hurt. What people say about us can either build us up or it can destroy us. So we have to be careful what we say about each other. The fourth thing is confusion. We become confused in our thinking and our emotions. We're not sure of ourselves and the things of God. 1 Corinthians 14 and 33 says, for God is not the author of confusion, but of peace. As in all churches, as the saints, we have to be on guard and attack against the devil. 1 Peter 5 and 8 talks about the devil as a roaring lion walking about seeking whom he may devour. We've got to be on guard. Hebrews 11 and 6 says, but without faith, it is impossible to please him. For he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. 1 John 5 and 4 says, for whosoever is born of God overcometh the world, and that is the victory that overcometh the world, even our faith. Faith is a substance. And that means a material or a matter of which something consists of. Faith is a tangible